How many of you have ever used a mat before? How many of you have ever refused to use a map and you realize after a while you should have used a map? That happens sometimes all too often. How many of you have ever been lost before? Right. You know, there are definitely times in life that we can get lost, and there's times in life that we need direction. You know, Billy Graham, one time early in his ministry, he was visiting a town. He was going to be doing an evangelistic service at a church, and he had a letter that he had to mail. And so when he was in this town, he needed to find the post office, and he didn't know where the post office was. And so as he was just kind of out on the streets, there was a young boy. And so he stopped the boy, and he asked him for directions to the post office. And the boy told him how to get there. And after the boy gave him directions, Billy Graham looked at the boy and said, "Now, son, if you come to church tonight, I can tell you how to get to heaven." And the boy looked at him and scratched his head, and then he said, "No thanks, mister. You don't even know how to get to the post office." Sometimes we do need directions in life. If you have your Bible, I want you to open up to John chapter 14. John chapter 14. As this morning, we're going to be thinking about the topic, when the road is uncertain. We started last week looking at a specific disciple of Jesus by the name of Thomas. Now, Thomas usually is labeled as Doubting Thomas because of an event that we're actually going to look at next week. But there's more to this fellow than that. This is one of Jesus' 12 disciples, a man who had been following Jesus for close to 3 years now. And, you know, when we look at the life of Thomas, there's not a whole lot that Scripture tells us about him. In fact, in the books of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and Acts, the only time he's mentioned is in that list of the 12 disciples. But in the book of John, he's mentioned a few other times, specifically with some statements that he makes or some questions that he asks. Last week, we looked at when the going gets tough, because there was a time when Jesus had left an area where he was, where the people didn't like him and they tried to stone him. And so Jesus and the disciples left that area to a safer place. But while they were there, Jesus got word that a good friend of his, Lazarus, was sick, and there was a plea for Jesus to come. And that happened to be in that same area where the people had tried to stone Jesus. And so when Jesus looked at his disciples and told them, "Let's go," the disciples said, "Jesus, they try to stone you. Why do you want to return?" And Jesus tried to teach them some important truths. And at the kind of near the end of that passage, Thomas spoke up and he said, "Let's go that we might die with him." You know, Thomas was one, he was definitely one who was devoted to Jesus Christ. As we saw last week, that Thomas was one who would rather die with Christ than live without him. And that's why Thomas said, "So let's go that we will die with him." Thomas was also determined, for he spoke that with courage. He spoke that with determination. But Thomas was also a guy who's very practical. He's a realist. Some people might say a pessimist, but he was one who it's hard for him to see other than what's at hand. And Thomas knew the facts. Well, this was the area where they tried to kill Jesus. This is where Jesus wants to go. I'm going to go with him. We'll go with him. And so we'll just have to die with him. And so he was a little bit discouraged in that, and it was hard for him to see the hope and the light that Jesus was. But he was one, like I said, who was definitely a determined and devoted follower of Jesus Christ. Well, Jesus did go to where Lazarus was, and Jesus didn't die then. In fact, Jesus rose Lazarus from the dead. But not long after that, Jesus did make his way into Jerusalem one final time. Because was Thomas wrong in thinking that, well, if Jesus goes, he'll die? Not quite wrong, it just wasn't quite the time yet, but the time was coming soon. And this is where we're going to meet and see Thomas again, this time in John chapter 14. For in John chapter 14, the disciples, they're with Jesus together, they're in that upper room as they're in Jerusalem, and there's been a lot of different emotions throughout the week, because not long before They remember the joy that came on the Sunday before that when Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey and the crowds were together and they were shouting, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Jesus was given a kingly greeting, for it seems that the crowds were excited about Jesus coming, that perhaps this is the king that God has promised for us. Perhaps this is the Messiah. And it was filled with praise and it was filled with joy and it was filled with celebration. But how quickly events seem to turn very quickly from that joy and celebration. For Jesus had been in Jerusalem now a few days, and during that time, Jesus had spoke to his disciples about once again his coming death, though they still didn't quite understand that and grasp that. And here specifically on Thursday, as they're in an upper room together, Jesus reveals to them a few things. He reveals to them that I'm leaving you soon. And this was the one that they had been with for 3 years. And they had seen the miracles that he had performed. And they heard the teaching. This was the one whom they loved and who loved them dearly. And he tells them, I am leaving you soon. And then to add to that, he also reveals to them that one of you are going to betray me. Now imagine their thoughts. And you know, here they thought, we're all devoted to Jesus. Which one of us would do such a thing? And then to add to that, Jesus specifically mentions to Peter that, Peter, you will deny me not once, not twice, but three times. And so they're in the middle of that upper room on that Thursday night. They went from that joy of that Sunday now to this kind of gloom and uncertainty and kind of darkness, as it was night outside. For a lot of them, it was seemed to be night in their hearts. The one that they loved was leaving. One of them would betray them, and Peter, the one who, man, we can always rely on Peter to, yes, kind of step and act before he thinks, but we can also rely on Peter to be Jesus' biggest defender, and yet Peter is going to deny him three times. And so they went from that joy and celebration on Sunday to that darkened and troubled time on that Thursday night. And so with all that in mind, let's hear what Jesus says, and then we'll see Thomas's question. In John chapter 14, starting in the first verse, Jesus looked at his disciples and he said, "Your heart must not be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If not, I would have told you. I am going away to prepare a place for you. And if I go away and prepare a place for you, I will come back and receive you to myself, so that where I am, you may also be. You know the way where I am going." "Lord," Thomas said, "we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way?" Jesus told him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." May God bless the reading of his word. You know, all of us at some point face troubling times in our life. I've heard it said many times, and I've shared it a time or two before. If you're not coming from a troubling place, then you might be in a troubling place. And if neither of those two fits, then you're about to be in a troubling place, because the truth is we live in a fallen, in a broken world. And all of us are all too aware of that. Sometimes there's very personal things that happen in our lives or in our families or with our dear loved ones. Such troubling things, and it can range from sickness and disease to sometimes relational problems or addictions in life, or sometimes you can't even necessarily put a point on it, just an overarching depression and gloom that sometimes can come to life. And when we look beyond ourselves and in our community that we live in, we're well aware of brokenness around us. When we hear from crime to accidents that happen to brokenness that's just in our community and even beyond that to our nation, you know, who would say that everything in our nation is great and going well? I don't think even the most optimistic person would say everything. And what about our world at large around us? There is so much brokenness And so it seems that there's reason sometimes for us to be troubled. There's reason sometimes for our hearts to grow weary and for our hearts to be burdened. And how can I get through this day? How can I get through the next? And for Jesus, the disciples, their hearts were heavy, and that's why Jesus looked at them and said, "Your heart must not be troubled." So how do we respond when our hearts are troubled? Well, Jesus gives the simple answer. Believe in God, believe also in me. Trust in God, trust in me. If you're able to do that, if we are able to do that, then we'll have no reason for our hearts to remain troubled. But how can we trust in God? What does it mean to trust in God? What does it mean when Jesus says, believe in me? It means to follow me. Well, how do we follow Jesus? You know, don't you sometimes wish that God would just give you a clear direction? You know, a billboard in the sign. Jesus, why can't you just appear and just speak to me plainly about how I'm going to get through this time? Just speak to me plainly about what my decision should be, what actions that I should take. Why can't you just come and just give me the words? Give me a, like I said, a billboard in the sky, or give me a sign. Have you ever asked God for that? God, just give me a sign, you know. Let me know what to do. And so when Jesus says, trust in me, and he then goes and tells them that he's going to leave, prepare a place, come back for them, and that they'll be with him, practical Thomas, he speaks up, because remember, he's one who's devoted to Jesus. He wants to be with him. So he likes what he's hearing when Jesus says, you know, I'm going to return and you're going to be with me. But Thomas, he has that good desire, but it's hard for him to figure it out because he's so practical minded. And so he says, all right, Jesus, how can we know the way? How can we know the way that you're going? We don't know exactly where you're going, so how can we know the way? Basically, he's saying, Jesus, give us a map. Give us directions. Give us a sign. Just speak plainly and show us how we can follow you. Show us how we can know the way. And you know, Jesus, what did he do? He got out a napkin and a... I guess they didn't have a pen, but, you know, a quill or whatever. And he drew directions, right? No. He answered, and what did he say? I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And so when we think about this, then what is it that Jesus is saying? He's saying, trust in me, because I am the way, the truth, and the life. So when it comes to trusting in Jesus, I want us to understand a few things this morning. First of all, we can trust in his provision. We can trust in his provision. You know, in verse 2, Jesus told them, in my Father's house are many dwelling places. If not, I would have told you, I'm going away to prepare a place for you. Now, where is Jesus speaking about? Where is his Father's house? It's heaven, right? And so when Jesus is speaking, we see a few things about heaven. First of all, heaven is a real place. You know, Jesus wasn't saying, you know, now just symbolically I'm going to go. No, he's saying I'm going to go there and I'm going to prepare a place. And because this is my Father's house, so heaven is a real place. There's different points in Scripture where heaven is referred to as a kingdom. Other places it's referred to as an inheritance. Other places, a country, or even a city. But here, Jesus refers to it as my Father's house. Because not only is heaven a real place, but it's a loving place. Because heaven is home where the Father lives. Now, home should be a place of love and warmth. I recognize we live in a fallen world, and that's not always the case. There are some people that their safest place is as far from home that they can get. But in the world that God intended, when you have parents who love each other and who love their children, then as the expression goes, home is where what? The heart is. Because that reminds us that home should be a place of love and of warmth. And when Jesus is talking about God as his Father, keep in mind this, that God is the perfect Father who never abandons, who never abuses, who never makes mistakes, who never misdirects, who never does anything wrong. God is the perfect loving Father, and so heaven is a loving place, a home where the Father lives. Many years ago, there was a missionary couple, Mr. and Mrs. Morrison, that were returning home to the United States from several years of serving in Africa. Well, on their ship that they were coming home, just so happened that the President of the United States, Theodore Roosevelt, was also on that ship, and he had been returning from a hunting expedition that he had in Africa. And this missionary couple, they, of course, watched the President and his party that was with him, and they watched all the celebration and all the to-do about the President. And when they finally got home to the United States, when the ship arrived, there was a band that was there. There were crowds that was there. There were the newspaper writers that was there. There was such a celebration there. But was it to celebrate this missionary couple who returned home after years of faithful service in Africa? No. It was for the President of the United States who returned from a hunting expedition. And Mr. Morrison, when he looked at that and he looked to see their welcome, which included not one person, you can imagine he was a little discouraged. And as he spoke with his wife about what had happened or about this, he said, something is wrong. We have given our lives in service to God in Africa all these years, and no one cares a thing about us. Here this man comes back from a hunting trip, and everyone makes much over him, but nobody gets two hoots about us. And so they got off the ship in New York, and they found a cheap flat on the east side for them to live, hoping to see how they could make it from one day to the next. And, that night the man said to his wife, "I can't take this. God is not treating us fairly." And his wife replied, "Well, why don't you go into the other room and tell it to the Lord?" And he said, "Well, I'll do just that." And so he was gone for a good while. And when he returned, his face was completely different. No longer was he discouraged with his heart heavy, but his face was aglow. And she said, "Well, did you tell the Lord about what's going on?" And he said, "I did." And he said, I told him how bitter I was that the President should receive such a tremendous homecoming and not one person was to meet us there at the dock. But as I finished, it seemed as the Lord put his hand on my shoulder and said to me, "But you're not yet home. You're not yet home." Because when we do get home, oh, what a celebration there will be, because heaven is a real place and a loving place where the Father is just waiting to welcome His children with open arms. Revelation 21, verses 3 through 4 tells us about heaven. "Then I heard a loud voice from the Lord. Look, God's dwelling is with humanity, and He will live with them. They will be His people, and God Himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will no longer exist. Grief, crying, and pain will exist no longer because the previous things have passed away." What a place heaven is, this brokenness and this burdensome that is all around us, and at times when our hearts are so heavy and troubled. We'll have no cause for that because heaven is a place where there is no cause for a troubled heart. Heaven is a real place, a loving place, but it's also a roomy place. For what did Jesus say? He said, "In my Father's house are many dwelling places." Now your translation might say mansions, but in the Greek it actually means a dwelling place, an abiding place. Because it takes the imagery from a first century house there in Jerusalem. What was custom in Jerusalem is that when a parent's son grew up, and when he got married, he would go, he would marry, obviously, his bride, and then he would return to his father's house where a room had been built on to the house for him to live. And then when the next son grew up and got married, he would do the same, and he would come back, and they would live in another room that was built on. And then, so these So the home had room upon room upon room for the entire family dwelled together. And what Jesus is saying is, in my Father's house, there's room enough for everyone. You know, God never has a quota where he says, all right, this is the last person, I have no more room, so the gates are closed, everyone else, you're on your own. God says there is room enough for all who will come. There's room enough for all. For in my Father's house are many dwelling places. So heaven is a real place, a loving place, a roomy place, but it's also a prepared place. For what did Jesus say? He said, I am going away to prepare a place for you. Now, on this earth, who is Jesus' earthly father? Joseph. And what was Joseph's profession? A carpenter. So when Jesus says, I'm going to prepare a place for you, does it mean that he's going up to heaven and he's using his carpentry skills to build those many rooms? Is that what he's talking about? No, not at all. In fact, 2 Corinthians 5:1 tells us this. For we know that if our temporary earthly dwelling is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal dwelling in the heavens, not made with hands. So Jesus is not going up and using his carpentry tools and his carpentry knowledge to build rooms. So what does he mean when he says, when I'm going to prepare a place? He's talking about the cross. Because notice what Jesus says, I'm going away to prepare a place for you. And how did Jesus go away? How was it that Jesus left his disciples? It was by the cross. Because it's through the cross that a way is prepared for us to be able to go to heaven. That is why Jesus said, I am the way. You see, Jesus followed his path to the cross so that he could be the way to the Father. In 1 Peter 3:18, the Bible tells us, for Christ also suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring you to God after being put to death in the fleshly realm, but made alive in the spiritual realm. It is by Jesus' death on the cross that we can have access to God. It's by Jesus' death on the cross that there is now a way for us to get to the Father. There is no map to heaven where X marks the spot. But Jesus is the way, and the cross marks the spot where the way was made possible. Jesus is the way, and because he is the way, we can trust in his provision, that he provides us a way to the Father. But not only can we trust in Jesus' provision, we can also trust in his promise. What did Jesus promise in verse 3? He said, if I go away and prepare a place for you, I will come back and receive you to myself. I will come back. That's the promise that Jesus gave his disciples. And I think He meant a couple things with that. First of all, he was talking about his resurrection. I'm going to go away. I'm about to die on the cross. But that's not the end of the story, because I'm coming back. Jesus, he lived on this earth. He ministered with those disciples for 3 years. He was arrested and found guilty, though he had done no wrong. He was nailed to a cross, and he was died, and he was buried and placed in the tomb. But 3 days later, what happened? He rose again. I am going to come back. His resurrection is truth. It's not a myth. There are people that believe, yes, we need to, in the Bible, figure out who the historical Jesus is, not the biblical Jesus, or not the mythical Jesus. So let's get rid of all the miracles. Let's get rid of the things that are just too impossible to believe, because obviously Jesus was a real person who taught good things, and he was a good teacher who spoke about love. But that's really all there is to who Jesus is. He's a good model for us to follow. But what happens when we strip out all the other parts about Jesus? What happens if we strip out his resurrection? Well, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 17 through 19, it says, if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. Therefore, those who have fallen asleep, therefore those who have died in Christ, they've also perished. If we have put our hope in Christ for this life only, we should be pitied more than anyone. If Jesus died, and if he stayed dead, then we're still in sin. We're still in brokenness. And there's still no answer to our brokenness. And for those of us who believe in Jesus and worship him, then we should be pitied before all men because we're just wasting our time here on earth. And you know, there's a lot of people in the world who say just that. You who believe in the eternal God, the mythical figure, this mythical Jesus Christ, you're just wasting your time. That's what the world believes because the world does not understand the truth. That Jesus did die, but he rose again. Now, there's people all around us that hear that story, but do they believe that it's not just a story? Do they believe that it's true? Because Jesus promised his disciples, "I will return." But not only was he referring to his resurrection, but I believe he was also referring to his second coming. That one day, our King is going to return. As Revelation 19 verse 11 tells us, "Then I saw heaven opened, and there was a white horse. Its rider is called Faithful and True, and he judges and makes war in righteousness." You know, once again, people believe that Jesus' return to this world, what Revelation speaks of, the end times, well, that's just a myth. That's not going to happen. Jesus isn't going to return for you. But it's not a myth, because he is called Faithful and True. That's why Jesus said, "I am the way and I am the truth." The promise of who Jesus is not just a fanciful myth, but it's a promise that we can hold to. It's a promise that we can depend on. As 2 Corinthians 1:20 reminds us, for every one of God's promises is what? Is yes in him. Every one of God's promises is what? Yes in him. You know, there's not one promise that God had made, not one promise that Jesus had made, that has yet been proven false. Because Jesus is the truth. And because he's the truth, then he gives us no cause for a troubled heart. When we're in those troubled times, it's easy for us to forget that we can hold to his promises. There's a story I heard of a father who is with his son, 8 years old, and his 10-year-old daughter, and they were off the coast of New Jersey, and they were swimming in the Atlantic Ocean. And they were having a good time together, swimming together. And as they were swimming, the father realized that the tide was sweeping them further and further from the shore. And the father knew his strength, what he was capable of, and he knew what he was not capable of. He knew he would be able to get one of his children back to shore, but not the other one. And so he looked at his daughter and he said, "You know how we've practiced swimming before?" And she said, "Yes." And he said, "And you know how to turn on your back and float?" And she said, "Yes." He said, "Well, I have to go back to shore to take your brother with me, but I'm going to return for you. And until I return, I want you just to be on your back, floating along." Now, he said this without any fear, for he didn't want to alarm his daughter. And she said, "Okay, Dad." And so she turned over and started floating as he swam back to the shore as fast as he could. So when he got to shore safely with his son, then he called for the lifeguard and called for other people to go and to get his daughter. And they searched and they searched for over 4 hours. They searched, knowing that she, if she was still alive, had been taken further and further from shore. Well, 4 hours later, she was found. And you know what she was doing? She was floating on her back, enjoying the sun, a smile on her face. And when they pulled her in, someone said, "Well, weren't you scared?" And she said, "Well, no, why would I? My daddy promised he'd return." You know, Jesus has promised that he's going to return. And no matter how long the night might seem, or how far it seems that we're drifting from peace and from home. Jesus has promised, I am the way, I am the truth, and I will return for you. We can trust in His provision. We can trust in His promise. And lastly, we can trust in His presence. For at the end of verse 3, Jesus told them, so that where I am, you may be also. Have you ever wondered what heaven is like? You know, as a pastor, that's probably one of the most common questions that I get. What is heaven like? What's it going to be? Well, we know what Scripture says about the streets paved of gold and the crystal sea, and we read about the throne room and all of that weird imagery that Revelation tells us about. But what really is heaven like? What are we going to be doing for all eternity? Surely we're not just going to be dressed in choir robes singing for all eternity. What's heaven going to be like? That's a fair question. And it's a question that comes across a lot of people's minds. I read about Doc Isaac Pinder, who lived in the 1930s, and he was the doctor of the town, and the town just loved Doc Pinder. He was one of those old country doctors who would go and make house visits. He was a godly man who loved people, and people knew that he loved them and he loved the Lord. And people also knew that he loved his beagle, for he had a beagle that would ride with him on his horse, on his horse and carriage whenever he would be going up and down the road. So whenever the doc went to make a house call, his beagle would be with him by his side. And when he got to the house, the beagle would usually hop off and wait on the porch for the doctor to finish his visit. And then when the doctor was done, he would get back up on the carriage, and the beagle would hop back on and ride with him to the next part. Well, there was one night when the doc heard a frantic knocking on his door. And Mrs. Hayes was there, and she said, "Doc, you have to come. Zeb, my husband, has fallen from the loft in the barn, and I'm afraid he's hurt real bad." And so the doc quickly gathered his medicine bag and what he needed with him. He jumped on that carriage. The beagle jumped up next to him, and he frantically went as fast as he could to get to the house. And when he got there, he went into the barn and he went to where Zeb was, and he looked over him and examined him and tried to treat him, but he came to one conclusion, that there really wasn't anything he could do, for Zeb's life was about to be finished on this earth. And he looked at Zeb, and he knew Zeb was a man who was not a Christian, one who did not know Jesus, one who did not have a loving relationship with Jesus Christ. And the doc said, "Zeb, I'm going to be honest with you. There's nothing I can do to save your life here on this earth. But Zeb, there is something that I can do. I know you've heard of Jesus. I know your wife loves him dearly. But Zeb, your life on this earth is about to be over with, but your life for eternity doesn't have to be over with. Zeb, if you will just turn from your sins and trust in Jesus, and He can save you." And as Zeb was there on the ground of his barn, he did just that. And the doc looked at Zeb and encouraged him and said, "Zeb, when you leave here, you're going to be welcomed into heaven. And it's going to be a great place." And Zeb, he asked the doc, he said, "Well, doc, what's heaven going to be like?" And the doc, he was at first unsure how to answer that question, for a man he knew didn't really know the Bible. He thought, well, in his mind, what good would it do to tell him about streets paved with gold? How can that comfort him in this time? And so as he was struggling for what answer to give him, he heard the scratching of his beagle outside the barn door. And God gave him an answer, and he said, "Zeb, you hear that scratching? Well, that's my beagle. He's been away from my presence for too long, and he's scratching to get in. Now, he's never been in your place before. He doesn't know what it's like. He doesn't know what goes on in here. But he knows who is in here. So Zeb, I can't really tell you what all heaven's going to be like, but I can tell you who's going to be there. And in the presence of Jesus, that's the greatest place that we can be. In Acts, in Psalm chapter 16, verse 11, the psalmist says, "You reveal the path of life to me, and your presence is abundant joy. In your right hand are eternal pleasures." You know, Jesus said, "Where I am, you may also be." It's all about a relationship with Jesus. Why do I long to be in heaven? It's not because of the streets that are paved with gold or for the crystal sea or for all those things. Why do I long to be in heaven? It's because who I know is there. God's family is there. Loved ones who have gone before that have trusted in Jesus are there. But more than any of that, Jesus is there. And that's why Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." How does one obtain eternal life? It's not by vitamins. It's not by diets or surgeries. It's not by seeking a fountain of youth or by doing good works or by being religious or by being baptized. No, it's not by any step or action, but it's by a relationship. That's why 1 John 5:11 and 12 tells us, and this is the testimony, God has given us eternal life, and this life is in His Son. The one who has the Son has life. The one who doesn't have the Son of God does not have life. It's about a relationship with Jesus Christ. And a relationship with Jesus Christ gives no cause for a troubled heart, because there is nothing but an abundant, joy-filled, eternal life. And because Jesus is the life, we can trust in His presence. So heaven is a place that I am longing to be. But notice that Jesus, yes, He said, "I'm the way, the truth, and the life." But notice what He said at the end. He said, "No one comes to the Father except through me." So heaven is an exclusive place. No one comes to the Father except through me. That means the way to heaven is only through Jesus Christ. No other religion, no other faith, no amount of good works. I don't care if you have one sin in your life and the rest of your life was filled with nothing but good works. For the wages of sin, not sins, but the wages of sin is death. There is only one way to the Father. It's not through being religious. It's not through being baptized. It's not through being good citizens. It's through Jesus Christ. Heaven is exclusive. He is the only way. Heaven is exclusive, and that is not a word our country likes to hear, because our country is all about acceptance and tolerance for everything, every lifestyle, every path. Surely every path will lead to heaven. But that's not what Jesus says. Jesus leaves no other option. But notice this: heaven is exclusive, but it is available. It's not exclusive only to the few, but it's available to all. For in Romans 10:13, it tells us that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. So when the road is uncertain, trust in Jesus. Billy Graham, early in his ministry, did not know how to get to the post office. But he did know the way to heaven. He's 97 years old now. If he continues living throughout this year he'll turn 98. And he still might not know how to get to the post office, but I can guarantee you, he does know how to get to heaven.
Years. And I've had a wonderful family that God has given me. And my wife. And as I think back over the years, I'm in a state of thankfulness. We're all sinners. And if we're sinners, then we are doomed. By that I mean, Jesus used the word hell. And that's the future of all of us, if we don't put our trust in Jesus Christ. will say, well, I don't really want a change in my life. Well, the scripture teaches without that change that God demands, we'll never get to heaven. Like me, I was a member of a church, but I hadn't really come to Christ. From the very beginning, I was reared in a Christian atmosphere. My father and mother both were Christians. By the time I was a teenager, there came an evangelist to our town, Mordecai Ham. I remember I got under such conviction. And one night, they gave the invitation to receive Christ, and I reluctantly went. But I really meant business with the Lord. I came just as I was, with all my sins, all my failures, and the Lord received me and changed me. That has transformed me till this day. I've never been the same. Jesus is the only way of life, eternal life, that he gives to every one of us that have put our faith in him.
As a holy city, a perfect environment in which a perfect society dwells. Heaven will be a place in which its inhabitants will be freed from the fears and insecurities that plague and haunt us in the present life. And the scripture says, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there will be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain. For the former things are all passed away, and we enter a new world. I'm looking forward to that glorious day of going to heaven.
I've found during the latter years of my life, when I've had sicknesses and been in the hospital and so forth, there's a peace that just resides there and stays there that I cannot explain. Everybody could have that same peace if they received Christ as their Savior. I know I'm going to heaven. I'm looking forward to it with great anticipation because of what Jesus did on that cross. He died for us, but he was raised by God. And you'll notice that when the disciples went out after the cross and the resurrection, it says they went out preaching that Jesus was alive and that because he lives, we too are going to live someday in that same resurrection glory.
We all die. I'm not going to escape it. I don't want to escape it. I want to go. The vast majority of my life has already been lived. My record has already been made. I don't have very much longer. I know that.
Some of my closest friends and relatives, and especially my wife, are already in heaven. And because of the hope we have in Jesus, we can all be in heaven someday forever. But first, there must be a decision here and now in this life.
Jesus said, I'm the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me shall never die. Never die. Never die.
So when Thomas, troubled of heart, said, Jesus, how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So the question for us this morning is, do you believe and do you trust in him? Will you bow your head and close your eyes? We're about to pray and have our time of invitation. And I ask you that question, do you believe in Jesus? Do you trust in him? Have you trusted in him? Do you have a personal relationship with him? If you do, then God commands us that we would go and that we would share, that we would prepare the way of the Lord, and we would let others know that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Does your life point to Jesus Christ? Does your life help prepare that way so that others can know and believe? Maybe you're here this morning as a Christian and your life has not been living, following after Jesus Christ. And today, maybe you need to return to Him. Maybe you need to renew your commitment, to renew your faith, to rededicate your life to Him. Or maybe you're here this morning and you don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. There's never been a time in your life where you have come to Jesus and you have turned away from your sins and you have surrendered everything and trusted in Him as the only Savior and as the only Lord. In this moment, this morning, the choice is for you. Will you trust in Jesus? Will you turn from your life and give Him all that you are, saying, Jesus, save me from my sins and be the one who is in charge of my life? Maybe this morning you need to trust in Him. If you know that you need to trust in Jesus Christ and you have never done that before, then I'm going to pray a prayer. And I want you to pray this prayer along with me. It's not these words that saves a person, but it is the heart's cry behind them. If you truly know that you do not have a relationship with Jesus and you want one, then pray this to God. Dear God, I know that I am a sinner. I know I do not have a relationship with you. God, I believe that Jesus is your Son. I believe that Jesus lived a perfect life and that He died on the cross to save us. Father, I believe that You raised Him from the dead. And today, Jesus, I turn from my sins, I turn from my life, and I give my life to You. Jesus, please forgive me. Please save me. And I will follow You. Thank You for saving me. Thank You for being my Lord. Amen.